have come into his house. Stand as we sing.
How's everybody this morning? I hope you're well, and I just want to say thank you for being here and just want to welcome everyone. And any first-time visitors, we want to say thank you for being here, and we're so honored that you're our guest this morning. And just want to bring a few things up as announcements right quick as we start before we go to our prayer time. We're going to do things a little bit different during the announcement period, but just remember, baby dedication on Mother's Day next Sunday morning. We'll be having Mother's Day, and we'll be dedicating our babies. Right now I have two names, and if you haven't given me the name of your child, please make sure I have the correct spelling and everything so I can get everything ready for that next Sunday morning. And then also remember, parents of high school graduates, Randall, do you want to share something on that?
Just remember, if you haven't already, I think I've talked to most everybody, but if you haven't already, I need those photos by the end of the day.
There you go.
Do it. So, but if you haven't given it to me, just get it to me before the end of the day today.
Yes, we're so excited. I know our seniors are probably excited. They're down, I guess, through with school. About just a few days left for all our seniors at Dixie BHB. I think that's where most of our seniors are this year. And we're just so excited for them. Be praying for them. What a exciting time it is, but it's also a time of new things, the future, what the future holds for them. So be praying for them as they make decisions there. Also, bylaws committee meeting this afternoon at 4:30. Don't forget about that. And also, Sunshiners, if you didn't sign up, you've got a chance to sign up on the 23rd of this month. The Haven of Rest has invited our Sunshiners to come down, and we're going to tour their men and women's facility and then have lunch with them out at the TLC campus. So if you would, just sign up right over there so they'll know how many of us are coming. And there's a sign-up sheet right over there. Men's breakfast, don't forget, this Thursday morning we'll get back on track. May the 11th at 8 o'clock we'll have our breakfast down at the old Smiley's. So if you can and would like to come for that, please come also for that. I think that's most of the announcements. Is there anything else before we move on to one other thing? Thank you. I was supposed to announce that. We will not have, the women will not be meeting tomorrow. So just remind everyone of that. If not, I do want to just welcome Amanda Thomas. Amanda, we're so glad you're with us today. She is with Gentiva Hospice. And Amanda, I'm going to have her, if she would, just come up. And she's going to share a few minutes with you about what volunteer opportunities are for us as a church. And she'll also join me at the back at the end of the service. And if you'd like to talk to her more, she'll be there to talk with you. Amanda.
Thank you so much. I am so honored to be here, and thank you for the invitation. I wanted to share with you, a couple of years ago, my grandmother was diagnosed with terminal cancer. And as a family, we were so stressed out. We didn't know how to care for her the way that she needed to be cared for. She was angry, she was upset, and we were just in a place where we needed help. And so hospice was called in. And I'll tell you, the biggest blessing of hospice was when that volunteer showed up at our house. And that volunteer sat with my grandmother. My grandmother was so mad. She was angry. She wasn't dealing with it well. And that volunteer read scripture to her, played gospel music for her, and it changed my grandmother's whole life. And it was very peaceful all the way up until the end. And we are so thankful for that volunteer, Miss Jeanette. She even came back when my grandfather was in hospice. She just made such an impact on our lives. And now I'm so honored that I work for hospice. And I get to be the volunteer coordinator and the bereavement coordinator. And so I pair our patients with a volunteer who will come and read to them. I've played Uno with people. I let them cheat. I don't like it. But I've played cards with patients. I've painted nails. I've watched TV. I've just sat outside on the porch and listened to their stories. It is a wonderful and sacred moment to spend time with our patients and our families. Sometimes our families just need to take a nap. And so for me to be able to sit there with them, with their loved one, keep them company, give them some happiness while they can go get a haircut or go to the grocery store or even have coffee just to have some time to themselves. And so I am always looking for volunteers. You don't have to do anything medical. I get a lot of questions like that, like, I don't know how to, you know, help somebody go to the bathroom. You don't do any of that. You're just there to be a companion and to be a friend. I've also had people who are veterans, and they like to talk to somebody that's a veteran too, because you share that common experience with each other. There's all sorts of ways that you can volunteer. We need people in the office that will call our patients and just check in, see how they're doing, if they need medicines refilled, or just to pray with somebody. There's so many different ways. And so I'm here. I'll be in the back after the service. If you are interested, it's not a big time commitment. We pair you with one patient, so it's an hour a week. It can be 2 hours every 2 weeks. It's whatever your schedule and the patient's schedule with the family. We work that out together. We have patients all the way in this area, all the way down to Seneca, Anderson, so a little bit everywhere. We have 55 patients right now, and I have about 12 patients that are really looking for a volunteer. So we're trying to get volunteers so that they can have those end-of-life moments as peaceful and as wonderful as they can be. So if you have any questions, I'll be in the back, and thank you again for having me this morning.
I can't say enough. You know, I'm sure we all, I think every family here is at one time or another has faced or had hospice have to be called in, and we've been there, so we know how important this ministry is and what an opportunity it is for our church to be able to maybe have an opportunity to volunteer and just make it a little bit more, you know, that's what we should do as a church. That's what the church is called to do, to reach out and minister. So if you feel led or just want to find more about it, maybe you're not ready to commit now, but maybe just go by and get Amanda's card and keep praying and just give her a call when you are. So that, I think that's great. I'd like to move on now to our prayer time. We have many that are sick and need our prayers. As many of you know, there's several people in our church right now that are have tested positive with COVID. Continue to pray for Miss Jean. She tested positive yesterday, and just pray that everything will go well with her. She really wasn't feeling well, so I told Ernie we'd be praying. Ernie, pretty sure he does. His test wasn't confirming, but he was going to take another test today, but he's got all the symptoms that she has. So we feel like Ernie and Miss Jean both have COVID. Dave and Shirlene Gordon are fighting COVID at home. Pray for Rhonda. Rhonda also is tested positive, so I know they'd appreciate our prayers. And I know there's some others not feeling good. Jennifer's not felt well. She has been to the doctor and got medicine, but feeling better. And Miss Mary's great-grandson, Waylon Trotter, 9 years old, appendix almost ruptured. They had to do surgery. He's in the Greenville Hospital. We want to add him to our prayer list today. And I know there's many others that need our prayers. Continue to remember Mr. Jack Chapman. Mr. Jack, I was able to visit with him. He was doing about the same this week. And then just continue to pray for that family. And then Joyce Trotter, you got the one call. That's Tommy and Mark's aunt. That she was the lady, the 90-year-old lady that was killed in the car accident down in Greenwood on Friday. So let's remember that family in our prayers. And I know there's others. Is there any other names or anybody that we want to just lift up at this time?
Pastor.
Yes.
Pray for me. I'll be traveling Tuesday to
New York. All right. Pray for Miss Diana as she goes back to New York for traveling. We will. Anybody else? Yeah, I saw that. Let's pray for that dear family, the McDonald family.
I'm Dwayne. Jason and Kristen and Emily will be traveling to Missouri to do that that research study for Emily next week. So it'll be Tuesday.
Okay.
And they'll be back late Friday.
Well, let's remember them as they go on that trip. Anybody else? Meeks family. He's a guy that works with me, his son, John. He's in his mid-20s, passed away unexpectedly. Meeks. All right, we will remember that. How about others?
Kevin, Daddy.
Yes, Dennis Reese, thank you. Kevin, we are continuing to remember Dennis Reese. Not doing well at all there, so thank you. Anybody else? Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and as we do, I'm going to just let you breathe maybe a few moments of silent prayer for some of these that God might lay upon your heart, and then I will close us in prayer. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity of prayer. We thank you, Lord, as we come into your presence. Lord, we don't take this opportunity and responsibility lightly. Father, even in my own heart, and I hope that's the prayer of all our hearts, Lord, if there's anything that would hinder our prayers from coming before your throne this morning, Lord, I pray that you would remove it right now. Lord, we just ask your blessings upon each one of these families, each name that has been mentioned, the families that are in bereavement because of the loss of a family member, Lord. We lift them up to you and pray that your comfort, your peace would be upon them. And Lord God, we pray also for all these that are struggling with the COVID. Lord, we just ask your blessings upon them and pray, Father God, that it would be a mild case. And Lord, that you would have them back on their feet and well real soon. For those that are Mr. Chapman, Lord, we pray for his family and all those that are with him, Lord, as he's battling this cancer. We pray, Father God, that your peace and comfort and direction would be with them. And, Lord, just continue to just be with him in these days. And, Lord, we do pray for Mr. Dennis. We ask your blessings upon him, Lord. We pray you'll be with Kevin as he looks after his dad. Just watch over him. And, Father God, we pray a special prayer for them. And, Lord, as we have already heard, the Meese family, the McDonald family, and the Joyner family, we pray for them, Father. What a tough, and it's just rough, Lord, on the family, so we pray your comfort be upon them. And Lord, we do pray for little Waylon. Is he there? Lord, we just pray that you just clear the body of that infection, and Lord God, that he would be back on his feet and running around his 9 years old due real soon. And Lord, I know there are many others, maybe some unspoken requests that we didn't lift up or say out loud, but Father, you know our hearts. And Father God, we pray that your will be done in those requests. And Lord God, as little Emily and her mom and dad will be flying out to Missouri this week, Father God, we pray as this study begins and they look, Father God, this will be where they can find some answers. Lord, we thank you already for how you've already performed some miracles in her life, but Father God, we pray that you'll continue to help her be able to walk, and Lord, just to continue to just grow up as a beautiful young lady as you've already started. Father, we just ask your blessings upon this time. We do pray for Miss Amanda and all her volunteers and her workers there at Gentiva Hospice. Lord, what a ministry that you have provided there, and Father God, I pray that if there's anyone here this morning or maybe that sees this on line, Lord, that would like to be a part of this ministry, Lord, I just pray that you'd just finger around their hearts and help them to connect And let us be an arm of that ministry. And Father God, we pray this morning as we come before you that as we continue to sing songs and worship you, and Lord, as we share in a message that you've given us, Father, we pray, Father God, that you would be glorified in everything that's said and done. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord Jehovah reigns.
get you up on your feet and go greet somebody in Jesus' name.
Well, I've told my Sunday school class this, that y'all just pray for me because I'm just not feeling well. And I don't think it's COVID. I test myself at least 3 times a week just because I have the tests at home, just to get rid of them. You know how when you get them free? But the song I'm singing this morning is one I heard 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I've about worn my voice out practicing it, trying to learn it for today. But have you ever heard the expression once and for all?
Yes.
Okay, I tell my kids, I'm going to settle this once and for all. And I usually say it like that. The title of this is Once and for All. And I have a new meaning for once and for all. So, all right, I'm going to try this. Just imagine all the sin this world has ever known, and all the bitter seed that ever will be sown. It was placed upon a man, the one and only Christ, who suffered on a cross on which I should have died. Once and for all, the Savior gave his life away to save the lost, to fight and win the war of love and hate. He paid the cost that only he himself could ever pay. He bled and the screaming mob below watched him cry his final cry. He didn't realize what just took place before their eyes. Then the earth began to tremble as the darkness settled in. The awesome sacrifice was now complete. Jesus broke the chains of sin. Once and for all, the Savior came to give his life away, to save the lost, and to fight and win the war of love and hate. He paid the cost that only he himself could ever pay. He bled. When he cast my every sin into the dark, defeated hell. Once and for all, the Savior came to give his life away, to save the lost.
Amen. We can go ahead and have the benediction, the invitation after that song and the music already this morning. What a wonderful time. And just the presence of the Lord here this morning. You know, with Amanda coming and sharing this morning about hospice and volunteer opportunities, and praying this week about what to preach about, and to be honest with you, just some of the things that are going on within our church family and even in my own life and even talking to some friends, God just laid a message upon my heart that I thought that I know I needed it, and I hope it's encouraging to you this morning. Because, you know, walking with God through the dark times, you can say hard times, difficult times. Has anybody here ever in your life hadn't been through any of those times yet? No. And you know, sometimes when those times come, it's hard to walk with God. We had back at Bethany, I used to have it was an older lady that taught youth Sunday school for about 50 years, Miss Rosa McAllister. Remember her, Bonnie? Y'all remember? Every Sunday morning, she'd open her Bible, and she'd always have her Bible marker was the footsteps in the sand. And when I was studying and thinking about this come back to mind how she always said, you know, no matter where I'm at and what goes through, when it gets tough, I always open this, and God reminds me he's carrying me through. You know, when you're walking with God through dark times, it's usually you're not doing the walking. It's him doing the carrying. As long as you'll see this morning some principles that I want to share with us. I think we all experience challenges in our life, don't you? And often they're connected to relationships, finances, family, health, and even our jobs or careers, whatever you want to say there. And a lot of times it's difficult to understand why these trials have to occur. We just don't understand it. I think it's in these times that we may feel so overwhelmed, so confused, so hopeless and helpless. When we're in the midst of these trials, it's not possible, you know, it is not possible to comprehend all God's plan is to what he's wanting to accomplish through these trials. We don't look at it that way a lot of times. But this morning, I want you to be reminded that Scripture assures us that God has our best interest in mind and will work through even the darkest and hardest times for our good. So if you're going through some difficult times or you're battling some hard things in your life, I want you to understand that the outcome that God has placed upon, maybe the things that are going on in your life, God's got an outcome that's best for you. And I think it is vital for us to understand the difference. All right, I want you to make sure you understand this morning. The difference between walking in darkness and walking through darkness. Okay, there is a difference. And we'll talk a little bit about that this morning. You see, as believers, we don't have to live in the darkness of sin. In Colossians 1, verse 13, it says, "For he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved." What a promise. What a wonderful promise. But we need to also understand, however, to refine us and to help us become all that he wants us to be, the Lord. Now listen. The Lord allows his children to encounter certain hardships and trials. And I said his children. Make sure you keep that in perspective. You see, in the story of Joseph, and that's where we're going to go this morning, we're going to look at Joseph's life. I'm not going to read a lot in there, but in Genesis chapter 37, verse 39, if you want to read about the life of Joseph and some of the hardships, and I'll take those chapters and just read them. And as we find in the story of Joseph, we discover principles by which to operate in our own life when our challenges come up, when we have some difficult and some hard times. But I think the first thing that we need to understand in these dark times is God is with us. If you're going through something right now, or if you've been through something, or you're facing some hard times, I want you to understand the first foundational experience that you need to understand, a principle, is God is with you. You're not alone. All right? So I need to make sure you understand that. Because, you know, think in Joseph's life for just a minute, could we? Because of jealousy of Joseph's brothers, they plotted to kill him, okay? But when you go back and look at it, what did God do? He changed the lives of Reuben and his other brother Judah, and changed their mind to help save him. When things look bleak, you know, they sent him off to be killed. But God changed the hearts of two to do what needed to be done. You see, Scripture tells us that the Lord was with Joseph every step and in every event, from slavery to the imprisonment. And even God prospered him and gave him favor with Pharaoh. So everywhere Joseph went, God was doing everything that needed to be done. I think we're reminded in Hebrews 13:5, God says, "I will never desert you, nor will I ever abandon you." Some scriptures say, "I'll never leave you or forsake you." But you see, there's no place. This is something I think we need to be reminded of sometime, because sometimes when you're going through hard times, when you're in those dark places, you think you're all alone. You think, oh, God can't come where I'm at right now. But I think we need to be reminded what Psalms 139 says in verses 7 through 12 or something like that. There's no place so remote, no situation so desperate that we can never be, that we will ever be beyond God's reach. Nowhere. Nowhere. No place. So that's the first principle I need you to understand, that you're never alone if you're going through some hard times. Your family may desert you. Your friends may desert you. But the main one will never desert you. And that's God. But the second principle I think we need to be reminded of is God has a purpose for allowing difficult times. Now, we don't like to talk about this too much. Why would God do this? But you see, God has a purpose for allowing difficult times. No matter how disastrous a trial seems, if you're, and listen to the words that I'm fixing to say, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, God has a specific reason for permitting the hardship in your life. We don't like to think that sometimes. But if you're a follower, look at Joseph, and I'm going to use Joseph as a good example. Joseph was 17 when he was sold into slavery. 17. A lot of you high school kids fixing to graduate, you're 17. This was when Joseph was sold into slavery at that age of 17. And as he was sold into slavery, it wasn't until he was 30 years old that he became what I call prime minister of Egypt. Now, back when I was in school, 30 minus 17 equals 13. That's 13 years of hard, dark times. So for 13 years, he walked right in the middle of what I call adversity. Every day, adversity. Sometimes when we're wrong, I know I do, our focus strays away from God to our situation or to the people who wronged us or to the thing that's causing us difficulty. We lose our focus on God and it moves over to our situation. But we need to be reminded, and I hope you understand what I'm trying to say this morning, God had a purpose for every step of Joseph's life. Every step Joseph was walking in that rocky journey for those 13 years, God had a purpose. You see, in God's plan, he would act as a savior not only for Joseph's family, but the entire Egyptian civilization. That's what God's plan was. He wasn't going to take care of Joseph's family, but he was going to take the whole Egyptian civilization. So every step Joseph was taking for these 13 years, God had a purpose for it. Think about that. Now, think about what Joseph later told his brothers in verse 50, because I think it's important for us to understand that when we're going through hard times. You see, Joseph told his brothers in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, "You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about his present result, to keep many people alive." You see, the Lord's sovereign direction of Joseph's life illustrates pretty much what I loved to be, as I always thought was my favorite Bible, one of my favorite Bible verses, Romans 8:28. God causes all things to work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. So I want to tell you something this morning. If you're going through some hard times, if you're going through some dark times, if you're going through some rough times, the darkness will only last as long as necessary for God to accomplish his purpose. Did you get that? Make sure you understand that, because it's very important. It's only going to last a short while, or as long as God needs for it to. You see, but here's my problem. I don't know about you, but when I'm going through those times, I become so impatient. Do you? You see, we become impatient during those stressful times. All the way to the end, sometimes we just get so, come on, God. But you see, here's the thing that I think we need to be reminded of this morning. If we could see through the darkness, if we could see through the difficult times to the end, we'd see our future. We would thank God, because we would understand his purpose for the trial. How about that? we could understand why we're going through this. We could see as he sees. Remember, he's up there and he sees it all. He sees differently than we do. And you see, I think that's what's so important. He sees the purpose for those trials. Now, let me ask you, how did God use Joseph for those 13 years? You see, through his experience at Potiphar's house, let's just say, this is how I understand, this is what I think we need to understand, how God takes us through these tough times and these dark times and these dark periods in our life. Let's look at Joseph's life, how God was using and what he was doing in Joseph's life during those 13 years. You see, during those 13 years, Joseph, as he the experiences he had at Potiphar's house and in prison, Joseph learned the Egyptian language. He didn't know it before he went there. He understood and got into the customs. He understood what needed to be done. And you see, the thing, even more, we don't even think about it, he learned administrative skills. He learned organizational skills, which... And he learned how to pretty much live under authority, which is hard for us sometimes. You see, he came to know how to manage others. You see what was happening in those 13 years? God was preparing him. God was preparing him for an awesome place of service as second in command to Pharaoh. See, sometimes we don't understand what God's doing, but he has a perfect plan in order. A perfect plan. You see, I think, however, God did not reveal to Joseph what we sometimes want him to do. He didn't reveal to Joseph the plan or the timetable during that 13 years. And let me tell you what, he doesn't do that for us either. He don't need to. We think God owes us an explanation why we're going through some tough times. We think God owes us the end results up front. No, we don't. We really couldn't take it if he did. You see, God did not reveal to Joseph the plan or the timetable, and he doesn't tell us that either. So even though we want to rush through dark times, we want them to get out of the way quick, realize that it is precisely these experiences that build the most character in us. So I'm telling you this morning, don't fight against God. I fight against God sometimes when I'm getting in these dark times. I think what we need to do, and I know what God's told me, he said, Dwayne, what you need to do is you need to start surrendering to me and say, Lord, I don't understand this. I don't like it. I don't want it, but I yield myself to whatever your purpose is. Keep me here until you accomplish your will. He said, that's easier said than done. Yes, it is. But you know, the only way you can do that is that first part of that, what I told you, you got to surrender. Surrender to God. You got to surrender it to him. Because, guys, we never can go through any hardships or difficult days if we don't surrender to him. Because we try to do it on our own. See, often we discover more in the dark times than we do in the, what I call the light times or the light. See, no matter where Joseph was, just think about this in Joseph's life. You know it. No matter where Joseph was, if he was at the bottom of the pit when his brothers dumped him in the pit, or if he was at Potiphar's house, or if he was even in prison, no matter where he was at, he was always doing this, walking toward the light. He was walking toward the light. You see, the entire time, God was moving him toward God's divine purpose. See, Joseph was to become the prime minister. His plan would save all those and would not only save Joseph's family, God's plan would not only save Joseph's family, but also the entire population of Egypt. And you see, his account of what took place here has been recorded in Scripture. It has been taught, and it has blessed countless of individuals throughout history because he was obedient. You know, I don't know about you, but I think we all prefer to avoid learning the hard way. I've learned the hard way a lot of times. Have you? The hard way ain't fun sometimes. But I want to tell you some lessons I've learned from that. You know, lessons I've learned don't become truly ours until they're tested and tried. When they're tested and tried, I believe I understand them a lot better than I do when they were just handed out. You see, experiencing God's dependability during dark times is infinitely more effective than hearing about His trustworthiness. Because let me tell you what, you sit in here, and we all do, we go to church services, we sit in pews, we hear about God's love, we hear about God's trustworthiness, but until we go through the fire, we don't understand it or acknowledge it. When it's tried and tested, then you understand it. You see, in dark times, this is something else. Listen, this is an important principle. In dark times, walk toward the light. Walk toward the light. Proverbs 3:7 says, do not be wise in your own eyes. See, God has the perfect plan for our lives when we're going through some tough times or any time. Only through trusting and following God in obedient faith can we carry out the plan that He has. See, we must obey even when life makes the right choice difficult. Let me repeat that. We must obey even when life makes the right choice difficult. You know, sometimes when those type of choices come, it calls for personal sacrifice. That's when it becomes real hard. Real hard. Why is it like that? Why is it like that? You see, because when those things get tough, when things are getting rough, when they're getting dark, our Father is building character in us. Character in us. And only faithful obedience will allow us to grow in wisdom and maturity to serve Him. Serve Him. Now, this is something that we need to be reminded of this morning. If you can't see the light at the end of your tunnel, wherever you're at, whatever you're going through, if you can't see the light at the end of your tunnel, you might be looking in the wrong direction. I know I do that a lot of times. I just can't see the light at the end of the tunnel because I'm looking in the wrong direction. See, don't focus on the darkness. Don't focus on your situation. Fix your eyes upon the Lord. Fix your eyes upon the Lord. That's the only hope during these times. You see, He won't, I guess you say, light the whole path. This is the thing. A lot of times we want God to put a light out there where we can see it all the way to the end. But that ain't the way He works. You see, He doesn't do it that way. He only puts enough light out there for you to make one step at a time. Because you got to be obedient in that one step. One step at a time. You see, in Psalms 119 verse 105, it says, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So you got to walk in it. What we learn in the darkness, we are to share in light. I tell you what, some of the toughest times are where I've learned how to help others and share when others are going through dark times. You say, here's the thing, young people, parents, this goes to show you, when you raise them in Christ, they never leave it. In Joseph was raised in a family who believed in Jehovah. We sung about Jehovah God. He was raised and the foundation of Jehovah God was put in his heart. So when Joseph ended up in the culture out there, society, that worship multiple gods, like there's so many multiple gods out in our world today, Joseph knew what to believe. And guys, if we don't teach that to our young people and our children today, they're going to grow up in church and disappear. We need to be putting the foundation of Christ in every heart. So when interpreting Pharaoh's dreams came about, Joseph did not in any way have to disguise his faith in the one true God because he had been grounded and brought up in Jehovah God. See, God is building scriptural principles into our lives every day. And He wants us to share His life-giving truths with others. That's why we're called to share the gospel. Share the gospel. Even in our dark times. See, people all around us are walking in darkness today. It's a dark world out there. There are so many people walking in darkness. They have anxiety. They're going through frustrations. And we need to make ourselves and the lessons that we've learned in the darkness available to them in their time of need. Sharing, volunteering, when people are going through some tough times. That's what God is making available to all. So this morning, as we close here in a minute, I'm going to be honest with you. You can say, well, my life's going pretty good. Well, I'm going to go ahead and prepare you. No life is free from dark times. No life is free from difficult times. I don't care who you are. You might want yourself to believe that, but if you got yourself believing that, you're believing a lie, and Satan is happy. And when those dark times come, I got a feeling you're going to be in trouble. But I think it's important that we learn from some of these principles that we see here in Joseph's life so that we can recall those principles when that hard times, those dark times, those difficult times come to us or even come to somebody in our family so we can help them. See, people are going through hard times desperately, want to hear that God is with them. Guys, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't care because you can even go to a lost person today. They maybe never come inside a church. If they're going through sickness or heartaches or trouble, they want to hear God's with them. They want to hear that. And we need to be able to share that. Because I don't care how dark that world is, they still know that there's a God. But this is where it gets a little tricky. I want to just share this for just a minute. You know, this guarantee that God says that he'll never leave us or forsake us, those promises are not a universal guarantee. See, it is only promised for those who have received Jesus Christ as Savior. Listen. Hebrews 13:5 says, make sure that your character is free from the love of money, being content with what you have, for he himself has said, I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you. Anyone who rejects the Son of God has no right to that claim. That's why we got to be ready to share the gift of life. You got to be ready to share Jehovah God, the Christ. You see, if you're not yet a believer of Jesus Christ, the wisest thing you can do is trust him. And guys, that's what we need to be able to share with people that's going through darkness. You got to be able to share the message of Christ. Amen. So they can have that claim. Yes, God is waiting, but he's made these promises to those who have invited him in. And he's not going to force himself on anyone. He's just waiting. So if you're going through darkness and you don't know Christ, he's waiting to be with you. Maybe that person you know at work or at school, young person, or something going through, maybe it's because they feel alone because they don't know Jesus. Acknowledging to God that you have sinned and believe that Jesus died on the cross in your place and paying your sin debt in full is all that God is waiting on. And you know, once you ask him into your life, what that person does, then all the rights and privileges and blessings and promises belonging to God's children will be yours. So this morning, you going through any dark times? Any hard times? Any difficult times? You know, are you in a tunnel and you don't see the light? Do you need to change directions? Do you need to start looking back at the light? Whatever it is, God's telling you this morning. Maybe you just realize, hey, I thought God was with me, but he's not because I've rejected him. I've done everything but accepted him. I've not surrendered. Whatever it is God is telling you to do, do it. Maybe you're here this morning and you just need someone to pray with you. Come on up, I'll pray with you. We got others who'll come pray with you. But whatever God is telling you to do, just be obedient. Because let me tell you, this is the first step, if you're in darkness, of seeing the light, is obedience to what he's telling you to do this morning. So won't you stand? And as we sing, don't wait. Whatever God's telling you to do. Quietly, as we just close our eyes, I feel God working as he's speaking to you this morning. Don't quench the Holy Spirit. Do what he's telling you to do. I wished I don't want to scare anybody. You can't. If I could scare somebody into salvation, I would. But during our prayer time, we were talking about a 17-year-old, a 20-something-year-old, a 90-year-old that met Jesus this week, I hope. You're not promised tomorrow. If you're standing right now and you know someone that's lost, just reach your hand up and let God know that you're praying for that lost person right now. Won't you do that? If you know that person's lost, just raise your hand and just lift that name up right now. Lord God, you see these hands. Lord, we pray conviction upon the hearts of every name that is being lifted up to you right now. Father God, give them another opportunity to come hear the gospel. And Lord, if we need to be that light, send us. God's people said. Amen. Kevin, come on up here for just a minute. Most of you know Kevin's been busy. He's not been busy. He's been a part of our church family for several months now. And Kevin come to me today, and he wants to rededicate his life. And Kevin has shared with me that in the past he was baptized, okay? But he thinks he got it out of order. Since baptism, he feels like he has gotten saved, and he's asked God into his heart. And he wants to come as a new candidate for baptism and a member of our church. So we got a move, we got a second back here by Billy, And what's the favor of the church? Amen, everybody. Kevin, we're going to be praying for you. Kevin and I are going to talk a little bit about baptism in the days ahead, and we'll get back with the church, but that is what we're going to be doing right now. And I just pray for Kevin. His dad has been in the nursing home for several weeks and just not doing well at all. And Kevin's his caretaker, and just pray for Kevin as he's there taking care of his dad every day and just making sure everything's there. And it's just been a difficult time, but continue to pray for him and pray for each other. And as we've talked about some hard times and some difficult times, I think we all know we've got a lot in our church family and our community going through that. We might need to be the light that God sends. Amen. And then again, we might need to be praying that God would send the light to us. But whatever it is, let's go out and shout and hallelujah and just tell people about Jesus. Amanda's going to join me at the door. Kevin, I'm going to ask you to join me too. And Tommy, would you close us in prayer?
Bring us back.